I will always give thanks unto the Lord. His praise shall ever be in my mouth. My soul shall make a boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. O praise the Lord with me, and let us magnify his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me. Yea, he delivered me out of all my fear. They had an eye unto him, and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed. Lo, the poor crieth, and the Lord heareth him. Yea, and saveth him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord tarrieth round about them that fear him, and delivereth them. O taste and see how gracious the Lord is. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
May the words of my lips and the inspiration of all our hearts be acceptable to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I was ordained to the diaconate 10 years ago last Sunday, and I served my curacy at the Church of St. John of Jerusalem in South Hackney. As some of you may know it. It's a vast barn of a church. It's a vanity project made by the first rector in the middle of the height of the Victorian Oxford movement. It was made of stone from his wife's family's quarry, which was soft and easily carvable, which meant that the outside of the church was effectively water absorbent, and after every rainstorm yet another gargoyle would have dropped off. But inside there was some delicate and powerful carving. Indeed, either side of the great west door were the carving of a man's head. On the left-hand side, the man's eyes are open, looking towards heaven. On the right-hand side, the man's eyes are closed, and the head looks down towards earth. A closer inspection reveals that the head on the right-hand side has clearly been detached from its body. The heads, and they were the same heads at starkly different times, belonged to St. John the Baptist, whose dedication was St. John of Jerusalem. They were either side of the great west door as a none too subtle reminder to the Victorian congregation of the primacy of Christ. John the Baptist, the cousin of Jesus, had, as we know, preached repentance in a hardcore fashion, emphasizing the need for good moral behavior and so that we should be saved. Fearlessly, he had criticized Herod, the sub-king of Galilee, for divorcing his own wife and marrying Herodias, his brother's wife. Imagine the sexual behavior of the ruling classes being subject to criticism by the church nowadays. It would be perhaps quite refreshing. Herod and Herodias, however, were determined to silence their fiercest and most outspoken critic. They decided it was easier to silence him than correct their own morally doubtful behaviour. Herod had done this through his powers first as sub-king to imprison John, to stop John preaching against them. One night, though, he gave a great feast, and his stepdaughter, identified in some texts as Salome, the daughter of Herodias, danced for him, and in a moment of drunken excess, Herod offered her anything she wanted as a thank you present for such an extraordinary dance. She didn't know what to ask for. She was a child. Her mother, Herodias, however, urged her to ask for John the Baptist's head. And Herod, in a moment of drunken vanity and inadequacy, acceded to her murderous request. The head was brought triumphantly into the great feast where Herod presided. But subsequently, Herod hears of the preaching of Jesus and his call to repentance, and has convinced himself that Jesus is in fact John the Baptist, who has been brought back to life, but only to persecute him and his wife. Great feasts are a feature of Christian belief and worship. Indeed, the whole of this Sunday's service will revolve around a great feast of thanksgiving, where we encounter Christ in bread and, pre and post-COVID, usually in wine. The great prayer of thanksgiving transforms the bread and the wine into the body and blood of Christ. We celebrate what's called the real presence of Christ in our midst, giving thanks for his sacrifice, his resurrection, and his promise to us of salvation and of our eternal life. Some people find the concept of the real presence of Christ, his body and blood in bread and wine, hard to comprehend, taking a hyper-realistic interpretation of it. It doesn't look like flesh, they'll say. It doesn't taste like blood. There is a great Catholic theologian called Macquarie who summed it up best when looking at the unprepossessing dry disc he is handed, saying, first, you have to believe it's bread. But remembering Christ in the Eucharist, the great feast of thanksgiving, is a central part of our lives as Christians. It is this sacrifice of love and the promise of resurrection that we give thanks for. That is the feast. Our feast promises life and love. Nothing could be further from the feast of Herod, which has the dead flesh of a prophet paraded round as a prize. And nothing could be further from the promise of the resurrection than the haunting words that finish our gospel reading. When John's disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. That is his final ending. That is the end of the promise. John has fulfilled his purpose. Every time I left the Church of St. John of Jerusalem through the great west doors, I would look up on both sides. And I would give thanks for the real presence, the real promise, and the real joy of everlasting life in Christ alone. Amen.
Hear the Gospel of Christ according to St. Mark. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason, these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah, and others said, it is a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him, and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him, but she could not. For Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod on his birthday gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I shall give it. And he solemnly swore to her, whatever you ask me, I shall give you, even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, what should I ask for? She replied, the head of John the Baptizer. Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was deeply grieved. Yet out of regard for his oaths and the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Little is much with God in it. Let us pray. We pray for our Queen, our Church and for the world, for our Bishop and Archbishop. We pray too for our clergy, Niall and Justin, for their lives of prayer and service, giving witness to God's love in our community here at St Paul's West Hackney. Loving God, we give thanks for your goodness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all people of faith at this time, their faith communities, and for the challenges which we all face at this time. We are grateful that we are able to practice our faith without fear of persecution. We pray that those persecuted know the hope God gives and how much God loves them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the great gift of your creation. We pray for salvation for all, for compassion and humility, that we may be the sign of God's presence and love in the world. We remember before God the nations and people in disaster, at war or in conflict, and those who exercise leadership within them, that they may have wisdom, insight for reconciliation. Almighty God, heal broken people. Bring us your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. On this day, we give thanks for all the love and blessings you have given us, for good health, our loving families, caring friends, and wonderful people we have met on our life journey. We pray that you continue to bless, protect, and guide us to overcome any challenges we may face. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we are alive with possibilities. We give thanks for all the good things we enjoy, for a peaceful sleep, a roof over our heads, and food on our tables. And we remember before God those who do not have these things. We give thanks for those who provide food and friendship through the tireless work of Open Doors, NLAH and Aquaba. Living God, be a hope that lightens our hearts, that we show kindness and generosity to others, whatever their needs may be. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We hold before you those in need of prayer and those who are unwell in mind, body or spirit. We pray for Pat Richardson, Danny, Louise, Jem, Rose and Elijah Graymore and Emmy Minton. Ever loving Father, strengthen, help and uphold us. Walk through our homes and hearts and heal us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We are grateful for the gift of new life and new beginnings, for signs of these things in this world and for the hope of them in the world to come. We pray for the departed that they may rest in peace and rise in glory. We pray that we too may be granted a share in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Rejoicing in the company of St. Paul and all the saints, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray for the mercy and protection of God's unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hello there. My name's Peter Robert Shaw, and I'm from originally from Yorkshire, near Sheffield. As if you know anybody from Yorkshire, you know that they'll tell you that immediately. I live now about 30 miles away from here, out in Buckinghamshire, and come in to volunteer at the Posh Club every Wednesday. In terms of work, I've sort of kind of retired. I used to be a marketing director for software and technology companies, worked for some big companies, but got sick of all that corporate world, so decided to pack it in, and so I'm just a gentleman of leisure now, and doing a bit of volunteering, done some stuff for Oxfam, mainly stuff for Posh Club, and also I am a bit of a photographer, so some of that I do for free, some sort of voluntary, and then some I actually get paid for. In terms of what I like, I'm very much a music and records person. Can't play any instruments, but I've been collecting records since I was 11. I've got about 25,000 records and CDs now, so a bit of an addict. My favourite record is probably, you know, it's what everybody says when you go back to your youth. So probably I like T-Rex and David Bowie. So 20th Century Boy by T-Rex, probably Rebel Rebel by David Bowie are really good, but also probably Dare or The Human League, because they're local guys coming from Sheffield. My favourite book, I've got a pile on the bedside table, but don't read so much now. I think phones have kind of stopped that happening so much. Probably from the past, it was 1984, and unfortunately it seems to be coming frighteningly true. Favourite film, similarly, don't really go to many films. Music's the thing for me. I did really like a film back in the 80s called Bad Timing, but actually when you look back at it, it's slightly dodgy. Person I most like to meet, I need a time machine because I'd like to go back and meet either David Bowie or probably more so Mark Bolan, who was actually born in Stoke Newington, I think. So he's a kind of local boy. Bit of a show off, bit of a dandy, so it'd be quite interesting to hear some of the tall tales he would tell. Things that I'm kind of missing most during lockdown and these sorts of times is really people, because my photography is all about people, and I hate doing things like still lives and landscapes that are just flat and boring and unchanging. It's people where everything changes minute by minute and they're most interesting. The thing that I'm most looking forward to doing post-lockdown, getting back to the theatre probably. Who doesn't love a musical? Well, not Andrew Lloyd Webber, obviously. So it'd be just nice to be sitting, being entertained, or a concert, something like that. And that's me, Peter, from the Posh Club. Thank you.
Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all now and always. Now, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.